Als Nederlandse co-productie die tot stand is gekomen op initiatief van een van de overlevenden uit dit kamp.
Deze muziek hebben deze vrouwen ruim 40 jaar geleden voor het laatst horen zingen. Ze zongen die toen zelf. Ze waren gevangenen van de Japanners tijdens de Tweede Wereldoorlog en hebben 3,5 jaar in interneringskampen doorgebracht op het eiland Sumatra. Dertig Nederlandse, Britse en Australische vrouwen vormden achter het prikkeldraad een vocaal orkest. Ze zongen er muziek van Beethoven, Brahms en Dvorak. Deze unieke arrangementen zijn bewaard gebleven en worden nu uitgevoerd door een koor in Californië. Sommige van de oorspronkelijke koorleden zijn naar dit reunieconcert gekomen om weer naar de muziek te luisteren die hen zoveel kracht en levensmoed gaf tijdens die ellendige oorlogsjaren. Twee leden van het toenmalig orkest, zuster Catharinia en Helen Colijn, keren in 1984 terug naar Sumatra. Ze brengen een bezoek aan Belalau, waar zich de moeilijkste tijd van hun leven heeft afgespeeld. Een tijd waarin er vrijwel iedere dag wel iemand stierf.
I remember when we had to bring people to the graveyard. We had to go up the hill. It was very heavy. People said, people who are longing for heaven are light. And people who don't want to die are heavy. That were the carriers. That was the theory of the carriers, which I didn't believe, but they told me. I very often was a carrier, so I heard them speak about it. She is heavy, isn't she? She doesn't want to die.
Er is niets dat de huidige inwoners nog aan die tijd doet denken. Niets roept vragen bij hen op over de geschiedenis van deze plaats. 40 jaar is er voorbij gegaan sinds dit rubberwouten toneel was van ziekte en dood. 40 jaar sinds het einde van de oorlog. Toen geallieerde vliegtuigen voedsel dropten voor hen die nog in leven waren. De kinderen van Belalau weten weinig van de oorlog. Inmiddels zijn we twee generaties verder. Ze zingen om de bezoekers een plezier te doen, niet wetend waarom ze zijn gekomen. Ze zingen een vaderlandslievend lied over het onafhankelijk Indonesië, hun eilandenrijk. Eilanden die voor de oorlog op het hoogtepunt van het Europees kolonialisme Nederlands Oost-Indië heten. Veel westerlingen leiden in hun volgens Europese stijl gebouwde huizen met inheemse bedienden een gemakkelijk, rustig bestaan in het Zuidoost-Azië van de 20er en 30er jaren. De Fransen bestuurden Indochina. De Britten Burma, Maleisië en Singapore. En de Nederlanders Oost-Indië. Helen Colijn kwam hier vanuit Nederland in de dertiger jaren met haar ouders en twee zusjes. Helens vader, Anton, was directeur van de Nederlandse oliemaatschappij. Ze maakte deel uit van een grote groep Nederlanders die in speciale wijken apart van de inlandse bevolking leefden. Ze hielden vast aan hun Europese zeden en gewoonten en trokken zich weinig aan van de groeiende anti-westerse beweging in Japan. De Japanse aanval op het westers kolonialisme barstte met ongekende hevigheid los in december 1941. In Europa waren Nederland, Frankrijk en Engeland in oorlog met Duitsland, waardoor hun Aziatische kolonies een makkelijk doelwit vormden voor de Japanse agressie. In maart 1942 was Oost-Indië door de Japanners veroverd. Anton Colijn werd gevangen genomen. Hij werd gedwongen zijn huis op het eiland Tarakan te verlaten en de Japanners naar de Nederlandse olievelden van Balikpapan op Borneo te brengen. Zijn vrouw zus werd als gijzelaar vastgehouden.
When I said goodbye to Anton in Tarakan, the last thing he told me, he said, whatever happens to you, don't feel bitter about it, because bitterness will destroy you. And that has helped me a great deal later on, because there were many things I was very bitter about. And then I thought the last word Anton told me, don't feel bitter about the things that will destroy you. And I didn't. I could put it off. It was his last gift to me.
Zus Colijn werd naar een interneringskamp op Borneo gestuurd, waar ze bijna 4 jaar zou blijven. Anton wist voor korte tijd te ontsnappen en trof Helen en haar zusjes op het eiland Java. Maar het was te laat om het eiland nog veilig te kunnen verlaten. Hun schip werd gebombardeerd en zonk de tweede dag voor de kust van Sumatra. Het gezin Colijn bereikte de kust in reddingsboten. Maar daar werden ze weer gevangen genomen en naar de stad Palembang gestuurd.
It was a tremendous shock to be captured. We had already survived the shipwreck. We'd been a week in lifeboats. We trekked for 3 weeks through the jungle. And I say we, my father and sisters and I. And there were 3 Japanese on a bicycle, on bicycles, and said, come with us, you're captured.
De zusters van Carolus Borromeus ontkwamen evenmin naar de Japanse strategie om niet-Aziaten te interneren. Zuster Catharinia was in 1938 op 30-jarige leeftijd vanuit Nederland naar Sumatra gekomen om les te geven op een kleuterschool vlakbij Palembang. In maart 1942 werd ook zij gevangen genomen. In het interneringskamp van Palembang zaten ook 32 verpleegsters uit het Australische leger die opdracht hadden gekregen om Singapore te verlaten toen deze stad in februari 1942 viel.
We were outraged that we should have to leave our patients. We'd gone to volunteered for service with the idea that we had a job to do. There was a job to be done. We had a skill to cope with it. And to be ordered to leave when we felt that the need was most, it was something we found very hard to take. And I remember saying goodbye to one young boy, not goodbye. You know, say, we have to leave for a while, we'll see you again. And he looked at me with imploring eyes, and he said, sister, when are we going home?
Het schip van Mickey Sayer werd gebombardeerd en vlakbij het eiland Bangka voor de kust van Sumatra tot zinken gebracht. Ook aan boord bevond zich de 25-jarige verpleegster Betty Jeffrey. Voor haar was het een opluchting gevangen genomen te worden na een afschuwelijke week op zee.
I had to row this little raft thing all night long, all that afternoon and all night long. And it, when I say row, all I had was a little piece of, the paddle was a little piece of stick like that, like the side of a fruit case, a wooden fruit case. It was very rough. and holding it like that and paddling like that, it just took more and more skin, took more and more flesh, and then off the palm of my hand too, till the bones were exposed. And now I have this scar here, which, funnily enough, is the shape of Banker Island, where we landed. So I always say I carry Banker Island around with me.
De Nederlandse en Britse kolonialen, de nonnen en missionarissen, de Australische verpleegsters, samengedreven door het onverbiddelijk geweld van de oorlog. Hun levenspatronen plotseling en gewelddadig verstoord. Volgens het officiële Japanse beleid moesten alle westerlingen in Azië tijdens de oorlog geïnterneerd worden. De Japanners hoopten dat de oorlog snel voorbij zou zijn. Dan konden ze de Europeanen, de Australiërs en de Amerikanen weer naar hun eigen land terugsturen. Alleen al in Nederlands-Oost-Indië werden bijna 100.000 niet-Aziaten opgesloten in kampen. Mensen met gemengd Aziatisch en Europees bloed werden soms wel, soms niet geïnterneerd. Een 26-jarige Indische Nederlands uit Palembang, Nel Mahodim, mocht kiezen of ze in het kamp of daarbuiten wilde wonen.
Inderdaad, die lui hebben me gevraagd, je mag vrij zijn. Toen had ik even om me heen, nee. Dat bevalt me niet, omdat ik nooit contact heb gehad met die mensen van Palembang zelf. En ik had altijd contact met mijn eigen vrienden, dat waren dus de Indischen en de Europeanen en de Hollandse gemeente, althans de Nederlandse gemeente. En toen zei ik, ik voel me niet thuis buiten. En dat was eigenlijk min of meer angst van mij om liever opgesloten te zijn dan buiten te zijn. Hè. Omdat die lui waren toen ze bij de inval, zag ik dus al die soldaten binnenkomen en dat viel me helemaal niet. Hè. We waren min of meer bang voor die mensen. Wat ook heel begrijpelijk is, want we hadden tenslotte pas voor het eerst zo'n oorlog meegemaakt. Niet?
Er waren talloze kampen, verspreid over Java, Borneo en Sumatra. In sommige kampen zaten soms bijna 10.000 gevangenen. De vrouwen en kinderen werden altijd direct van de mannen gescheiden. In het kamp bij Palembang zaten aanvankelijk zo'n 300 vrouwen en ongeveer 100 kinderen. In leeftijd variërend van pasgeborenen tot een jaar of 16, 17. Sigrid Stronk, vrouw van een Nederlandse planter, had twee kleine zoontjes toen ze van haar man werd gescheiden en in een kamp werd geplaatst.
People always say it must have been very, very hard for you as mothers with children. I don't so. I think it has been harder for us than for the others. I don't think so. I think we were privileged even to have children, to have something really to live for.
In the beginning, when they could play together, every day was still a wonder for a little child. When we were in the houses camp, it was quite, of course, they were naughty, and they did naughty things because they had no playing material. But the children needed schools, and I knew it was necessary. So we tried to get some children to give lessons to them. There were no books. Some had some copybooks, but not more. But in the houses, we find libraries. And from the libraries, we took books.
There was a copy of Victor Hugo's Les Misérables, and we struggled, or I struggled through that. And I think we did some math. But that, too, didn't last too long, partly because of materials missing and energy levels getting lower.
Een ander kind dat les kreeg van de non in het kamp was de 11-jarige Nederlandse jongen Theo Rottier. Maar hij en zijn broers werden ook beïnvloed door de sfeer van oorlog om hen heen.
We were always running around in military uniform because we could find helmets and ammunition pouches, and we made ourselves guns with catapults and all that. So initially there was a sort of British army emerging and a Dutch army emerging, and you're talking about seven boys this way and seven the other, the more or less grown up, the 12, 13, 14 year olds, and always fighting each other.
De Japanse bewakers waren over het algemeen inschikkelijk tegen kleine kinderen, maar hun gedrag jegens de vrouwen was onvoorspelbaar en vaak wreed. Misverstanden kwamen dagelijks voor omdat bewakers en gevangenen niet dezelfde taal spraken. Ook de culturele verschillen waren groot. In het Japanse leger werden ondergeschikten al vaak voor het kleinste vergrijp door hun meerdere geslagen. Het was dus niet zo verwonderlijk dat de kampbewaarders hun woede koelden op de vrouwen bij de geringste overtreding.
The food of the camp used to come in a sort of truck driven by a Japanese driver, and it was thrown out of the truck onto the ground, the road. And then the driver drove away. But he left behind a box that had contained vegetables of some sort. And I saw this and I thought to myself, we haven't got anything to sit on in our little garage where we lived. So I just picked it up and took it home. But somebody saw me do it. And there were traitors in the camp, you know, ones who thought they would gain something if they told about some misdemeanor on the part of somebody. And somebody told on me. And so there was a cry for the one who had taken the box, you see. And I, for the sake of everybody else, I took the box back down the hill to the spot, handed it with a bow to the Japanese gentleman, who proceeded to wah, 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 wah. That was that. So I didn't ever do it again.
There is an incident I can think back on with pleasure. And that is when we were rounded up in the first camp, which was a group of houses with a fence around it, we noticed at one point that far away beyond the gate on the road, there were prisoners coming by every day, every morning, with a guard. And so when we saw that, or when the women saw that, we would all rush down and see what we could see, but the three of us climbed on the roof of the house in which we were, and we had found a towel, and we waved with this orange towel in the hope that Father would see this, which he did, and waved back. So far, yet so close, but at least we knew they were there, and everybody recognized his father or her husband or whatever it was. That was in the beginning.
Het gezicht van de meisjes Colijn, die schreeuwde en zwaaide vanaf het dak, had Bill McDougall, een Amerikaans correspondent die na de oorlog priester werd en die samen met Anton Colijn in het mannenkamp gevangen zat, opgemonterd. Maar op een morgen in december 1942 hoorde hij niets meer uit de richting van het vrouwenkamp.
Christmas Day, we went out, and instead of screaming, there was silence, dead silence. And suddenly we heard singing. And across this abyss between us came this beautiful, "Come All Ye Faithful." And then silent night. We stood there with the guards around us. The guards moved, they flew, move on. They were entranced too. And it was really so moving, we wept. Even now I think how wonderful that was to give us this life, spirit.
Zingen vormde de belangrijkste afleiding voor de vrouwen in het kamp. Terwijl de ene drukkend hete en vochtige maand volgde op de andere en angst langzaam plaats maakte voor frustraties en verveling, zongen de vrouwen 's avonds liederen. De meeste zangbijeenkomsten werden georganiseerd door de Britse zendelingen Margaret Drybrough, die voor de oorlog in China en Singapore had gewoond, waar ze les gaf in Engels en muziek. In het gevangenkamp was Miss Drybrough een stuwende kracht, steeds meer activiteiten organiserend om het moreel op te vijzelen. Ze schreef gedichten en toneelstukken. Ze vrolijkte verjaardagen op met tekeningen of speciaal daarvoor geschreven liedjes. Maar na 18 maanden gevangenschap vond ze dat de vrouwen iets nieuws nodig hadden om hun lusteloosheid op te vijzelen. Nora Chambers, die muziek had gestudeerd op de Koninklijke Academie in Londen, bracht Miss Dryborough op een idee.
I said, I wonder if we could try classical music without words. For instance, music that is done by quartets or symphonies or whatever. And she sat me and she said, yes, let's have a try.
Margaret Dryborough bleek te beschikken over een uitzonderlijk goed muzikaal geheugen. Ze had geen bladmuziek, geen muziekinstrumenten, maar ze kon zich de melodieën en harmonieën van zo'n 25 stukken voor piano en orkest herinneren. Die arrangeerde ze voor 4 stempartijen. Het vocaal orkest was geboren.
Margaret and I didn't realize it at the time. We were thinking really of doing something different. And slowly but surely we began to realize that it was drawing more and more people together. It was a sort of unifying thing. There were the Australian nursing sisters, 2 sets of Dutch nuns, nursing nuns and teaching nuns, and there was 1 New Zealander. There were Dutch Eurasians and British Eurasians, and there was even Chinese, 1 Chinese. And also, things were a bit mucky and in a mess, and it was not a very nice place, and you had to think of something that took people's minds off things. And we used to have these rehearsals at night with 1 little lamp, and they sat on boxes, and we wrote the music out as best we could on bits of paper. And we started to sing and started to learn.
It was something we had never done before. And so at first we would try out the score altogether. And then after having done that and finding out where the mistakes were, some of us would go on our own together, and having copied the score from Nora or Margaret Dryborough, we would then try out the weak spots.
We were having one of our rehearsals in the Dutch kitchen one night, and everything was going along beautifully, and it was, of course, superb as usual, and everybody enjoying themselves. And we did the unfinished symphony, or we were doing the unfinished symphony. And apparently I came in solo halfway through on a wrong note, and Nora, who was conducting us, just collapsed. It was really terrible. She had her hands up conducting us, and then down they went, and everybody just collapsed. And that was the finish, as I say. Geoffrey finished the unfinished symphony, I'm afraid.
And all the solitary voice let out the C sharp, and we all just laughed. Even now she teases me and she says, I'm sure it wasn't me, it must have been somebody else. Yes, we had a good laugh over that. We had lots of laughs, which was great, which again was great for the morale.
De dirigente van het moderne koor, Patricia Hennings, werkt met een bijna 2 keer zo groot koor als tijdens de oorlog. Tijdens het repetitiejaar kreeg Miss Hennings brieven van haar voorgangster, Nora Chambers.
She says, Grieg's morning, all the runs started off with law. You remember when doing runs in singing lessons, we did them all to ah, legato. Mind you, it isn't easy to sing the runs legato, but have a try. Don't forget, Patty, if you don't like the idea, do it your way.
Ik herinner me even dat stuk van, wat ik me zeer goed herinner is, ik weet niet precies hoe dat heet, maar dikwijls hoorde ik dat stuk Danny Boy. Ken je nog herinneren?
Danny Boy.
Danny Boy. Ja. Oh, dat vind ik een schat van een stuk.
Dat herinnert
je? Ja, en heel duidelijk ook, omdat het zo, ja, wat zou ik zeggen, dat is zo'n verdrietig stuk, hè. En voor de rest, ja, ik kan niet op al die namen komen, ja. Maar in elk geval, het was interessant. Dat was meer een, min of meer een, hoe noem je dat toch eigenlijk, een afleiding en een vulling van geest.
They worked very hard and considering the condition they were in physically, I don't know how they were able to sing some of the things we asked them to sing and how they were able to hold their breath for long phrases. And you know, they were in a weakened condition, but they did, and I was very proud of them.
Following Nora was just so easy. You just did what she made. Well, she made you do it with her hands, her expression, movement of her head, and you just did it. It was a marvelous experience, the whole thing, and of course the music itself, having it and doing it. You just were not in a dirty little scruffy, tatty prison camp in Sumatra. You were way out in the open. You just seemed, you know, free, somewhere beautiful.
After a year, we suddenly had to go to the Japanese guard's house, not knowing what was going on, because you never knew what was going on with these fellas. They were absolutely unpredictable. As we walked through that corridor into that backyard, a walled backyard, and you're perfectly in the, let's say, it's the scene there for an execution. Yeah, it's a walled garden there, and we stood there, and we were ordered to undress. One of these fellas, the one of the older boys, still whispered to us, "Hey, we're not going to undress." Japanese overheard that, and in as short as possible, and in time, he got a few slaps around and a few kicks, and we were out of our pants in no time. And there we stood naked, and they looked at us, and they said, you, report at 4 o'clock in the afternoon with whatever personal belongings you have, and you're off. Where? Nobody knows. Yeah, we got back to the camp and, told our mother, of course, that we were off in the afternoon at 4 o'clock. And that must have been horrible for my mother and for all the other mothers who were involved, 8 or 9. And at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, there we went. But the strange thing is, we didn't know where we were heading for. Destination unknown. And a clear sign of that is, had they known that we were heading for the man's camp, we would have been loaded with messages, letters, or whatever, and we arrived with nothing.
After a year and a half in this houses camp, we were moved suddenly to, only a mile away, I think, to a camp in Palembang with barracks, the ramshackle barracks with flimsy roofs, covered with palm frond, and every time a storm blew, the leaves blew off and the water came onto the platforms on which we slept, crowded together there. At some time we only had no more than 2 feet width to go along to sleep on. There were cockroaches, bed bugs, rats, all kinds of things that we didn't have in that first camp, and the food gradually became very, very bad.
Well, they'd bring in an egg. Well, what do you do with one egg between that many people? And, you know, mind you, everybody's hungry and everybody's eyes are watching that one egg. Do you give it to one person and hope that more eggs will come in so that everybody gets one eventually, or do you scramble it and give them a spare? You know, all sort of irritating things like that. They'd bring in vegetables or a couple of times a week. It was mainly canned kong, which is a bit like spinach, I suppose.
They used to bring in some meat and throw it down on the ground, on the bitumen, put their foot on it, get their bayonet out and hack it into pieces, and then just throw it to us as though we were dogs.
There was an awful lot of sickness, and you got weaker every time you were sick with this malaria, the dysentery, the beriberi, every blessed tropical disease you could think of we had, and we tried to nurse it. Well, we did nurse it.
no beds or anything like that. They were just lying shoulder to shoulder. And we would have to step up onto the thing and nurse them onto the bed space, which was just like a long, long shelf, about 6 feet wide and about 50 feet long. There were these poor people, and all we had were rice sacks to put over them.
You didn't have the medicines, and the Japanese wouldn't give you any. They just refused. You had no treatment for malaria or amoebic dysentery or any of these, pellagra or beriberi. Nobody received any treatment. Once in a while you might get a bit of quinine bark, but that was very rarely.
And I was looking after these patients with beriberi. Now they swell up, and you can't bend your legs, you can't lift up a step, you had to lift your leg up, even a step that high, you couldn't lift it yourself. And one of the nuns, her arms were so swollen in her body, she couldn't feed herself because she couldn't bend her arms. And if you went like that, her skin just peeled off. And I used to feed Sister Olga. She was a Dutch nun. And I think she was an engineer by profession. She was a very well-educated woman. She used to say to me, "Sister Vilma, you are so good. Thank you so much for looking after me. I am going to my Father in heaven, and I will pray for you." She used to say that to me every day, and eventually she did die.
You were so quite sure one day it will be gone. It can't be forever. Someday the war will be finished. The war will be won, and then things will come back again. That was a trust in you.
Het vocaal orkest repeteerde tijdens de herfst van 1943. Daarna gaven ze in december hun eerste concert. Vol verwachting verzamelde het publiek zich op het plein voor de barakken.
It was Christmas time. And everybody came and round this square where we were, and the choir came in with their little stools. They weren't strong enough to stand. And then the crowd gathered around, and then the Japs got a bit annoyed. A guard came up with his bayonet and said, the sign language and sounds they made, because we didn't understand what they were saying. But we understood what he meant. They didn't like people gathering in crowds. And I didn't take any notice. I thought the best thing was to carry on, which I did. I raised my hand and we started. And strangely enough, he stopped and he just sat there and listened. And it did a tremendous amount of good for those people in the camp. A lot of them were weeping. I think it brought memories back, and I think it was a good thing from that point of view.
The festive way they came, the way they talked about it days before, and the way they tried to make up a little bit, to be different from other days, and the festive way they were sitting and listening and talking about it afterwards, it was something that grew in between us, and it lived in between us, and it made us more near together. That was the wonder of the music.
1944. Het geestdodende kampleven duurde voort, af en toe opgeluisterd door concerten van het vocaal orkest. Alle vrouwen werden steeds zwakker en steeds bezorgder over hun dierbaren. Er was geen enkel betrouwbaar nieuws over de oorlog te krijgen.
We were in prison camp almost 4 years, and all that time we had no idea what the war was doing, where my husband was, what happened to my girls, and all of us were in the same condition. That was almost the worst of being in prison camp, was the isolation from the world.
In september 1944 moesten de inmiddels ruim 700 gevangenen opnieuw verhuizen. In gammele bootjes werden ze via de Mushi-rivier en over straat Banka naar het eiland Banka gebracht.
When we arrived at off Banka Island in this sort of paddle steamer type of thing, we couldn't get right into the wharf, and they had to put us into this awful junk thing, and we jumped into this junk, and it was about 4 inches deep with kerosene or some horrible volatile fluid like that,
which we had to sit in. And then they closed the roof, and there were quite a number of us in there, packed shoulder to shoulder, and it was pitch black, and it was dreadful. And they set us adrift from the ship, and we immediately started to get seasick. Then there was an air raid, and it was all awful. And by the time we finally reached that wharf, and they opened up the hatch, we were just semi-conscious. And it was not until I got into the new camp, I put my hand round my back to get my diary, and I realised I didn't have it. And I thought, oh, where is it? How dreadful, somebody's going to find it. Because, you know, not allowed to have papers, and I thought, off with the head. So that was all right. I couldn't do anything about it. But next day I had a pretty awful dose of malaria, and I was just lying there on my bed space with a temperature, feeling ghastly. And along came a Japanese guard, holding up the little bag of thing, calling out, you know, Hapa, Hapa, you know, who owns it, who owns it? And I said, yeah, I do. And he brought it to me, and I thanked him very much, and it was marvellous. Nobody had touched it, they hadn't opened it. You know, they're peculiar, they did some funny things, but they did some very good things too.
Het leven in het kamp op het eiland Banka was een ware nachtmerrie. Drinkwater was schaars, latrines moesten met de hand worden geleegd. Vanuit het omringende moeras dreigde een nieuwe, fatale ziekte, Banka-koorts.
Het was New Year's Eve 1944, rond midnight. En ik was in bed en ik had this terrible Banka-fever we all had, shivering and cold and miserable. En dan het was near 12 o'clock en at the other end of my barrack, Sister Katrina and other sisters were singing. Just for the new coming new year, the end of the year and the coming new year. And then I was lying there feeling horrible and I thought, oh, I wish I could sleep now, forever.
The mothers who died, that were the mothers who took so much care of the children, who gave part of their food to the children. The best thing for a mother to do was take her own portion and give the portion to the children that she got for her children. But if she gave more to the children and ate herself less, she couldn't go on very long. And then she died. And the little children came to us. And they were wonderful, clever little children. But they were all round little bellies full of water. If you have no food, slowly you grow bigger, but you grow bigger full of water.
Japan was aan de verliezende hand. De bevoorrading van voedsel en medicijnen verslechterde ziende ogen. De Japanse officier, belast met de medische zorg voor het kamp op Banka, was dokter Kumihiko Yamada.
医薬品などは特に不自由しておりました。ただ医薬品の配給っていうのはその戦闘する部隊を優先的に多く配給して戦闘に参加しない部隊には少なくなると。例えば党の役員があったとすると航空隊のような実際に戦争する部隊には5つ行ってそれで戦闘しない例えば緑竜署とか通信隊とかそういうところの部隊には一つぐらいしか配給にならなかったというような関係です。
Ondervoeding, ziekte en dood brachten tenslotte het vocaal orkest op het eiland Banka tot zwijgen.
We all began to peter out physically and we lost 15 members of that choir and by then it was quite hopeless we couldn't carry on. And so that was the end of it, but it was a tremendous thing while when it happened. We didn't realize, Margaret and I, what it would mean, but it was tremendous.
De manuscripten werden verstopt. Dierbare herinneringen aan minder moeilijke tijden. De vrouwen klampten zich nog steeds aan hun muziek vast. Maar hun verzwakte lichamen konden zich nog maar amper staande houden. Laat staan dat ze nog konden zingen. In het kamp voor de mannen waren de omstandigheden niet beter. Theo Rottier zat er inmiddels bijna 2 jaar. Gescheiden van zijn moeder en jongere broertjes. In januari 1945, na maanden smeken bij de bewakers, werd hem een kort bezoekje toegestaan.
We saw the barracks camp and there was barbed wire. And we were standing 5 meters on this side. And suddenly my mother was there on the other side. With 3 of my brothers still. Later I heard that when she knew that we were there, she quickly dressed up and tried to get a sort of long skirt on to hide her beriberi legs and to hide that she was fully emaciated by that time. But yeah, it was only a matter of 2 minutes. You could hardly speak or something. You could only wave a little. And yeah, okay, then we had to get onto that truck again. And yeah, that was the end. Because 3 months later she died.
...76 vrouwen en kinderen stierven in het kamp op Banka in de periode van oktober 1944 tot april 1945. Maar het ergste moest nog komen. Zonder duidelijke reden moesten de gevangenen ervoor een 3de keer verhuizen. Een 3-daagse reis per boot, trein en vrachtwagen bracht ze diep in de Sumatraanse jungle... ...naar een rubberplantage, Belalao.
En de kinderen waren zo very weak. They were no child anymore. They just were old men and women sitting together and talking about food and looking at the kitchen. They just went to the side of our barrack that had a view on the kitchen. And then they took their little benches over there, sat together in a little row, looked at each other, at this side, at that side, and were speaking about what are we going to eat. And they told each other, every day the same story. It's Cancun today, yeah? Cancun, 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 Cancun.
Somebody died. The coffins were buried outside the camp. And in the beginning, the Japanese did the digging. I know there was one day when, instead of being one hole that was built, 8 were. Even though 8 people hadn't particularly died that day. It was the Japanese having some ready in advance, which was a hurtful thing too.
I remember when we had to bring people to the graveyard. We had to go up the hill. It was very heavy. We had to dig the grave ourselves, put in people you know so well, you knew so well, and then we had to close it and went away. And later, Nora Chambers made some crosses with the names on it. Do you remember?
Yeah, she burned them in the kitchen, yes, with a nail.
Yes, she couldn't stand it, that they were just somewhere. They want to have the name of the one who was under the earth now.
Kort na de reis naar Belalao werd Margaret Drybera, oprichter van het vocaalorkest, ernstig ziek. Op 21 april 1945, slechts 4 maanden voor het einde van de oorlog, stierf zij.
It was as many of us who possibly could were there for that, because she meant so much to the camp. She had given so much of herself in so many ways and created so much beauty.
Voor
just before the end, strange things started to happen. I mean, we got more food, if I remember right. And they became a bit the Japs became a bit jittery. And then one day we were called all together, and the camp commander came in and said, that must have been on the 24th or the 28th of August, I don't remember exactly, 45. And he said, Prang Suda Abis, the war has ended. And there we stood. And I remember feeling, and mommy did say, we felt like a balloon which had been pricked with a needle, you know. Oh, that was it. We hadn't imagined, at least I hadn't imagined it so differently, that you would really explode into an expression of joy. But it didn't happen. It was very curious.
We heard the war was over, but nothing changed. I was sick, others were sick. My father wasn't there to celebrate with anymore. We had heard about 3 months before that he had died in a men's camp. And the vaguest idea where my mother was she still alive? We hadn't heard from her for almost 4 years. And other people were in the same boat, in the same condition. So not really until 2 weeks later, the first food was dropped, did we have a sense that the war was over, that there was actually something happening in our lives that was different from all those other years that had gone by.
And suddenly the Jap said, well, the children are allowed to go to the men's camp, who was also at Belalau, another part of this rubber estate, and see their father. So we all tried to find something clean and still a little bit nice, and dressed our children. So Gijs Willem was 3.5 and Dirk was 9.5. And they were ready to go. And then I think it was Sister Katrinia who came to me. She probably, or Mother Laurentia probably had got a list. And she came to tell me that he died already at the end of 44. And then for the children, it was very, very hard, of course. All the children went to see their father and they just stayed behind.
Veertig jaar na het eind van de oorlog wordt er vlak bij Amsterdam een reunie gehouden. 80 mannen en vrouwen die in de kampen nog kinderen waren en enkele van de Nederlandse nonnen die daarvoor hen zorgden, zijn hier bij elkaar gekomen. De meesten hebben elkaar sinds de oorlog niet meer gezien.
Just an ordinary group of women. I think every one of us was a different personality, but it would seem, looking back on it, as if nearly everybody in that camp was hand-picked, because you just did cope.
We learned to understand each other, we learned to depend on each other, and we learned to help each other, and it was a tremendous experience.
Oh, one should be grateful for all the things one learned. Gave us such strength that it was built into our lives somehow or other. It's the most incredible business.
After 40 years, I hadn't thought very much of the camp. It was far away in my mind. But the music still stayed. And every time when I heard in a concert hall or on the radio parts we had sung, then that came back again.
Thank you.
going, Audrey.
It's spring to life.